So, hi, this is a short video on YouTube trying to help you start to understand the relationship between your low back pain and the tightness in your hips. So, follow along with this exercise and start to learn how you can open your hips by lengthening your low back. And we do that by learning how to move our fascia in tight corners inside of the tightness. When you start to learn how to move your fascia, you will find that things will open in continuum and give you a ton of reprieve. So I wanted to return to an older exercise that I used to do all the time when starting to really rearrange and organize my hips and lower body to heal my hip restriction and low back problems. And I understand that most people with low back and knee problems have a hard time even kneeling. So I'm gonna show you a couple different versions of what it looks like to kneel. We should, when I first started this, I actually, GST, I could not kneel either. It felt like my kneecaps were gonna rip and it felt like I couldn't, like, my ankles were so tight that I couldn't, like, sit on them. And so we have to get there, and this is one of the exercises that will help you do that. If you have a roller, a foam roller, this could be very helpful for you to sit lengthwise on it, because we're gonna start practicing this action of the pistons of the QL. Your QL is a four-sided muscle on the back of your low back. It attaches like the paddles of my hands to your pelvis and your rib cage, and it's like this. Most of us are extremely tucked under, so it actually becomes like a flexor rather than an extensor pushing up the weight out of the low back. It actually pulls down like a flexor on the low back. One of the things that it's supposed to do is be able to drop force down through the pelvis and lengthening it in these lateral types of motion. And I'm gonna just give you a full progression of how to be able to start doing some of this flexibility of the spine to the hip. So go ahead and put your hands on your hip bones and let them rest there. You're gonna try to roll your pelvis off to the side of your right heel and then back. And then you're gonna release and go over to the left side and come back. That's the simple action. This might also be very tender on your pelvis from underneath, like in between where the saddle of a bike would be. Make sure that you're up on your sit bones. It will be a little bit tender because this is areas of congestion that are in your pelvic floor, keeping you also tight in your low back. So, let's go into the simple action. Once you understand that you're doing this, so I'm just gonna exaggerate it, okay? Once you know that that's the action you're doing, I want you to do it micro, as a micro movement. Why? Because I would like you to feel that when your sit bone tries to go down onto your heel, the spine and the rest of the tissues should move to the left as a counter pull, okay? You don't want this. And if you have one tightness on the right side, you will flip over and move to the right. And if I go to the side here, it's the same thing. It tends to want to, like, pull us. So we're trying to actually think about the sit bones going like pistons long and then releasing back up. And I can feel how the SI joint can, without shortening this side, lengthen down and long. Let's talk really quickly as you're doing this. Keep following along. As the pelvis tilts, you want to really see the difference between skeletal tissue and muscular tissue, okay? Or I should say soft tissues, because it's muscle and your fascia. Skeletal bones behave differently than hard things, behave differently than soft things. And so we're gonna let the bone move, but you should feel the awareness that your first quartile can go in and make different things happen in the soft tissues. So when I feel like my sit bones slide and lengthen, I can still feel like the first quartile pulls front to back and long. We really need to get this movement in the QL because it discharges. It, like, literally shares the load that's in your low back by joining your QL to the a muscle called your iliacus down into the base of your pelvis, which will then become a hip flexor and turn into motion of your leg. And we just lock everything up so there's no way for it to move and progress and share all the way down. So do this a couple times because it's going to be the basis of the opening for the hip, okay? And I would do this until I could feel that I could get my first quartile all the way down. Two things to think about when you're doing this. When I'm sitting, I'm not under myself. If I'm in a tuck, I'm not able to feel this very nice lengthening that comes off the QL, the rib cage up here, down into my spine. We're gonna add a little bit of a side bend now to get an additional stretch and then feel what it's like to let our tissues animate to pull us back. So you're gonna let your roller go to the right, and if you're not on a roller, it looks like I am taking my hip to the floor. Let me do it without. If you can do it without the roller, it's a very different experience. I wanna be able to get my hip to the floor and still have, instead of this happening, be able to maintain both sides of my spine. And then I'm gonna pull back up to center. I'm gonna do this without because now that you know how to do it, try without. I am using my hand to lower, but I'm making my tissue release out into the stretch to go. And then I'm gonna pull back to come up. Good, to the side right, lengthen. And then I pull, instead of shortening on this side, which most people do, you wanna pull yourself back by how you lengthen the first quartile. Let's do it one more time. Press, and I slide myself off and try to keep both sides of my spine parallel. And test. Most people do not have bilateral symmetry in their strength on their spines, meaning both sides of their spine are not strong in the same ways. One is overly tight, one is weak. And so you're gonna feel like you fall in or like you can't get up and over, and this is what we're trying to create. So these are micro adjustments on the inside. We roll the pelvis, and then we're teaching the tissue that instead of being tight up, it's gonna go with you, and it pulls long, and then I can come back. And what you'd like to be able to do is eventually be able to do this without. There was a time when I could do it without the hand. But you can use your hand, no problem, as long as you're getting that in and up. Now, from the side, we're gonna add another movement. I'm gonna slide off to the right. You're gonna take your right hand, and you're gonna push slightly forward, okay? What this is gonna do is start to pull you back, like if I let the motion happen. But we're trying to create traction, and here's why. We want the pelvis, or the spine, to start seeing the dimension between where the leg is in the pelvis and where it is. When we tuck, there is no dimension, they slam together. So you're gonna push with your right hand, and as you push, it allows you to pull back on your first quartile, and it lengthens your QL, okay? I push with my hand, and then I lengthen these muscles and increase the distance between my floating rib and my back body, and then release. Again, we're gonna press and allow it to open, stretch, spread, and release. Good. One more, push, open, stretch, and release. Good. Then you're gonna keep that nice openness back to come up rather than shortening it, okay? Let's try the other side. So, sit on the knees, lengthen to the side, okay? And then I'm gonna push my left hand forward. It's gonna push me back to start getting that openness all the way into my low back. Press, hand forward, and check. When you push, does it round you too fast? It's gonna show you if you have the length in your spine or if it shortens you under. You wanna be pushing the low spine back to open rather than it coming under you like that. Push and open. One more. Push. Releasing and release. Good. Now we're going to switch to the side. Once you have one side sit on your right, the next progression is we want to be able to bring this knee up and down. Most of the time, because of how we've taught, the knee comes into us and it bends us over. And so we're going to use some of these micro movements, pressing up and over, to try to create length as I lift my knee, okay? So it's not doing this, I'm able. Check this out for a second. Try a side bend and see if you can bring your spine too vertical without crunching on this side. This is another biggie where I need to be able to have the strength to create this. You could use your hand for a minute and then fit to form. If you pull with your hand, then you can make your muscles start to go into this shape and then strengthen to match that. We pull up and over, hold, stretch, pull, and then release. Let's try it on the other side. Just as a precursor, because we're trying to get the spine to really have length on both sides and know where it is. So see how mine wants to do this, part of my pattern. So I try to create a nice evenness in the ribs, and then I'm gonna pull and start strengthening my back body to move over. What's so interesting about fascia is that instead of trying to fix from these major muscles in the spine, if I take my first quartile and I lengthen it, watch, first quartile and lengthen it, it naturally pours my weight over, which is different than me trying to do it from here. That really changes the tension lines that I feel. So that's why we were working this first quartile, pulling down and back into the hips as your actual animators, how it goes. So now let's go back to the right. Okay, we're gonna go now for keeping your body upright as we try to lift your knee. So you're gonna lift the knee as far as you can and observe. Most of the time when the knee comes up, it shortens here because we haven't created this kind of length. And we're gonna do that now. So the knee goes up, and I'm gonna precede the action of the knee with this deepening of my first quartile. Watch from the side. I think you can see this. So when the knee is up, instead of it tilting me over, I'm gonna pull back and try to create length. That same piston action, this is what it looks like from behind. So when my knee comes up, instead of it crunching in, I'm gonna lengthen it down and around, pulling me to vertical, and then I try to keep that as I close. You're gonna let your knee come up. Watch that it wants to push you. You have to lengthen and really pull long on that left side. It goes back to us switching the knees. So as you're going right and left, we're teaching the body how to get these lengths to facilitate this motion. And you pull back on the first quartile and then release. We'll go from the side three times. It comes up, stretch, spread, and then I pull long, and then I'm going to release and open. Good. Again, pull down around the hip and coming in. Now you can resist on the coming down. So put your left hand on the inside of your left knee, and as the knee comes in, you can be pulling back to create the decompression of the hip. Try that a few times. I go down deep into that first quartile, and then when the knee closes, I pull back to get that kind of length. So I'm doing it on both sides of the action. We'll do two more. Inhale, coming up, and then releasing. And one more, press, open, pull, and coming in. Good. Do it from the front on this side, and I'll show you. So a simple action is, knee is gonna come up and close, okay? You can use your hand for now. Ideally, we're going to start making these adjustments so that I could keep my spine vertical as my leg comes up and then as I close, okay? As I lift, I'm tractioning, my spine is opening to make way for my hip. If I do not create spinal length behind me, not under me, if I do not create decompression, this can't open because it's shoved forward and you'll feel really locked in that joint. So as the leg opens, I start moving the spine and the quadratus laborum to open. And then I resist on the way down. And I'm teaching the spine how to have tensometry on both sides, that strength and length in the low back. Press. Right here, it wants to lock up, pull the first quartile to open and back, then pull. And as I resist bringing the knee in, I traction back under. And I would spend hours, because this looks really smooth on me, but it was not. I would literally stay here and be like, this is so locked up, why? Do not be afraid of stopping in between, going back and revisiting, because if you bypass something that's not open, you're not sequencing. And fascia really relies on its sequencing for synchronicity, how things flow and don't get stuck. So take the time to make sure that you're animated the entire cinematic experience, every frame of motion. has the same opening that's happening so that it'll stretch and release. Try that quite a few times. You really need to be able to have the opening of the spine to open the hips. And it all rests around how your spine perceives dimension between where the leg and the hip are and the length in order for it to be able to move back and around. This is a great foundational exercise for many of the other moves that we do. Once you understand how to move your fascia in tight corners, you'll start to know how they can animate in other exercises. So enjoy that, and you'll find different ways to build on that in your work. If you like what you are seeing today in terms of different hip exercises to help heal you, please leave comments in the section below. Subscribe to our channel. We would love to have you join our community and our conversation about how fascia is evolutionizing our understanding of bodies and the care of them, what it wants, what it needs to be most vital. You can find us anywhere that you like to socially connect, on Instagram at GSTBody or Anna Rahe of GST. You can find us on Facebook and on the World Wide Web, www.gstbody.com.